गाय गौर मधुर स्वरे गाय हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा 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 हरे हरे
हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा 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 हरे हरे
तको सदा हरि बोले डाको
गृह थाको वने थाको सदा हरि बोले डाको
सुखे दुखे भूलो नाको वरने हरि नाम करो रे
सुखे दुखे भूलो नाको वरने हरि नाम करो रे
गाय गौर मधुर स्वरे
गाय गौर मधुर स्वरे
माया डारे बद्ध होए आछो मिटे काजो लोए
माया डारे बद्ध होए आछो मिटे काजो लोए
माया डारे बद्ध होए आछो मिटे काजलोए
माया जाले बद्ध होए आछो मिछे काजलोए
एखनाते तनते राधा माधव नाम बोलो रे
चेतन पे ये
राधा माधव नाम बोलो ले गाय गौर मधुर स्वरे
गाय गौर मधुर स्वरे
हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे रामा रामा रामा
हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा 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 हरे हरे
जीवन होइलो से नाव दिले ऋषिकेश
जीवन होइलो से भजिले ऋषि के
भक्ते नौ पदे एक बार नाम से मातो रे
भक देवी नौ पदे एक बार नाम से मातो रे
मधुर स्वरे
गाय गौरा मधुर स्वरे
हरे कृष्णा उल्टा हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे
हरे कृष्ण हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे
हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे
हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे
गौरांगिताय श्री गौरांगिताय गौरांगिताय श्री गौरांगिताय
गौरांगिताय श्री श्री गौरांगिताय गौरांगिताय श्री श्री गौरांगिताय
गौर जय जय श्री चैतन्य जय नित्यानंद
जय जय श्री चैतन्य जय नित्यानंद
जय द्वैत चंद्र जय गौरभक्तवृंद
जय द्वैत चंद्र जय गौरभक्तवृंद
जय जय श्री चैतन्य जय नित्यानंद
जय जय श्री चैतन्य जय नित्यानंद
जय द्वैत चंद्र जय गौरभक्तवृंद
जय द्वैत चंद्र जय गौरभक्तवृंद
जय जय श्री चैतन्य जय नित्यानंद
जय जय श्री चैतन्य जय नित्यानंद
जय द्वैत चंद्र जय गौरभक्तवृंद
जय द्वैत चंद्र जय गौरभक्तवृंद
पावन हरिनाम संकीर्तन की अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की श्री श्री गौर निताय की श्री श्री राधा कुंज बिहारी की श्री प्रभुपाद की ओम अज्ञानतिमिरंधस्य ज्ञानांजन शलाकया चक्षुः उन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः नमोम विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे सो दिस द बस वी वर यस्टरडे 171 करेक्ट मणियचे अभिकृते प्रसवे हेमभार जगद्रूप हय ईश्वर तबु अविकार
द टचस्टोन आफ्टर टचिंग आयरन प्रोड्यूसेस वॉल्यूम्स ऑफ गोल्ड विदाउट बीइंग चेंज्ड सिमिलरली द सुप्रीम पर्सनालिटी ऑफ गॉडहेड manifests himself as the cosmic manifestation by his inconceivable potency. Yet, He remains unchanged in his eternal transcendental form.
Yeah. So it's very long purport, but you can see it. Just we can just watch it. What he's saying. Janmadhyasayata, he is quoting. And see, Prabhupada here says one important thing. See, only read this much, only selected portions we will read. Yeah.
The Supreme Lord is the master of innumerable eternal energies, which are unlimited. Sometimes these energies are manifested and sometimes they are not.
Yeah. You know the word manifested. What is the meaning of manifest? For example, Prabhupada gives in the Bhagavad Gita introduction, you all must have read it. He says that, you know, like when we went to Vella, you know, when we were going in the car, we saw over the bridge, the water was gushing, flowing, such river was overflowing practically, below, that water, and the forest was completely lushy green. It was looking so nice, because rain had dropped, the trees and plants were all still wet, dripping with water, flowers were blooming, and that, you know, everything was colorful. So we were actually going for searching land that time, for the Vella, purchasing a property. So, later on someone told me, this is a rainy season, it looks like this. But then if you come in summer season, everything will be completely dry. You will not have any of the creepers, plants, greenery can hardly be seen. So this example Prabhupada gives, try to understand this Prabhupada's beautiful analogy. He says, the sun, the moon, the stars, they all are fixed in their positions above. They don't change. They always exist in that position. But you will find that fixed means, of course, they may move also, but they all exist, continuously exist. Whereas the cloud is formed in the sky at a certain point of time. And when the cloud pours forth, at that time the greenery also comes on the earth everywhere. And then in another season, what happens? There is no more rains, there is autumn, the sun starts shining brilliantly, eventually summer comes, everything is dried up. So what example Prabhupada gives? The upper truth should be taken as spiritual, and what you see on the earth, this truth should be considered temporary. So the effect of the rain on the earth is compared to the effect of the three gunas on the jivas. When the three gunas impact the jivas, they become colorful in what? Tamaguna, Rajaguna, Sattaguna, varieties. And each of these three characteristics, each of these three have a specific characteristics. Like Nidra, Alasya, Pramada, that is Tamaguna. Sangha and Trishna for the Rajaguna. Sukham and Jnanam for the Sattaguna. Then all living entities are all wearing this three gunas. And they're running here and there, the world looks bustling with activity. They put the board, no city never sleeps, isn't it? Earlier, when they advertised like this, city never sleeps, it was a sign of pride. That whole night, we have, you know, lights on and so many activities go on. But now, lack of sleep has become a big curse in many places across the globe. They are eating sleeping pills to go to sleep. Because they are unable to sleep now. This world appears to be very colorful. People running hither and thither and doing activity. But that is due to this living entities getting nourishment from the three gunas. Correct, no? From there they are getting. And you will find this three gunas effect always keeps the world in a flux. Flux means changing. Sometimes Rajoguna becomes powerful. So the demons become powerful. And they drive up the demigods from their post. And they occupy the Indraloka. Correct, no? Like Bali Maharaj did. Correct, no? Another time, the Sattvaguna becomes prominent. When Tamoguna becomes prominent, then night culture becomes the real culture. People nowadays have three shifts now. Nishachara means one who keeps awake at night. Now there are many Nishacharas now. Correct, no? When we sing in that song, Shri Ramam Dasharatatmajam Aprameyam Sitapatim Raghukulan Mayaratna Deepam Ajanu Bahu Aravinda Dalayataksham. And then he says, Nishachara Vinashakaram Namami. There it goes. Nishachara Vinashakaram. If you are awake at night, that is finished. Who is the Asuras? They are the ones who keep awake at night. But now other fellows are also awake now. Correct, no? Night one is supposed to sleep. So why this world is bustling with activity? Because of the gunas, which is like the rains pouring and then activity. And then at one point of time, what happens? There are no more clouds. No clouds, no greenery, no activity. After the pralayakal, everything stands still here. Prabhupada says, but the sun, moon, stars, they always exist. The spiritual world is like that. Yasya sarvesha bhuteshu nashyatsu navinashyat. It's like that. So he's comparing this to Bhutva Bhutva Praliyate. That's the situation of the material world. Yeah. Ratri Agame Avashapartha, he says. Yeah. So therefore he's saying here, Supreme Lord is the master of innumerable eternal energies, which are unlimited, but sometimes these are manifested. Like when is greenery manifested in this world? Rainy season. Sometimes they are manifest and sometimes they are not. Other times it is dry. So the material world also, the three gunas, when they manifest, sometimes it is bustling with activity, sometimes in pralayakal it is standstill, like that is saying. Go ahead. In any case,
all energies are under his control. Therefore, he is the original energetic, the abode of all energies. A common brain in the conditioned state cannot conceive of how these inconceivable energies abide in the Supreme Personality of Godhead. How he exists in his innumerable forms as the master of both spiritual and material energies. How he is the master of both manifest and potential powers. And how contradictory potencies can abide in him.
See, there are two types of powers. Some powers are manifest. Like right now, electrical energy is manifest in the form of light now. When you are walking in the road, there may be electric wire lying. And it may be just inactive. You put your feet there, you'll get a shock. So it's in a dormant potential state it is. Correct? But here it is in a manifest state. It is being converted, electrical energy is being converted into light energy now. Sometimes it may be, this is a manifest state, but it may be in a potential state. Both are possible, correct? Like coal, for example. When you keep a coal stocked in your storeroom, that is in a potential state. But then you put it in a furnace and heat it, then it will be red hot coal. Then you're cooking sabji or something. That is a manifest state, correct? No? So your energy can be in a manifested state or in a potential state. Like all the jivas, Vishnu, what is that state? Huh? Potential state, yeah. Right now, all of us, we are in which state now? Manifest state, like that he is saying. Huh? Yeah, like that, yeah. Isn't it? So, similarly he says here, but in any case, he is the master of, Lord is the master of all the energies, he is saying. Yeah, As long as
the living entity is within this material world, in the condition of illusion, he cannot understand the activities of the inconceivable energies of the Lord. Thus, the Lord's energies, though factual, are simply beyond the power of the common brain to understand. When the atheistic philosophers or the Mayavadis, being unable to understand the inconceivable energies of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, imagine an impersonal void, their imagination is only the counterpart of materialistic thinking.
See, one fellow had never drunk milk in his life. So, somebody said, hey, would you like to take a cup of milk? He said, what is milk? I don't know, he said. He said, oh, the milk looks like the color of a crane, like that, he said. Then immediately he imagined a crane in his mind. And he said, oh, the crane has got a twisted neck. If I drink that, you know, my throat will get stuck. I don't want, he said. You understand, no? Because he was trying to imagine milk to be like what? Color is same, but the shape of milk is not like that. Correct, no? Therefore, if you try to explain the spiritual truths with material examples, the impersonalist can never comprehend. That's what he is saying. Correct, no? Yeah. Go ahead.
Within the material world, there is nothing inconceivable. High-thinking philosophers and scientists can tackle the material energy, but not being able to understand the spiritual energy, they can simply imagine an inactive state such as the impersonal Brahman.
Because they are using an empirical approach. Because when you use an empirical approach, the material energy is easily accessible to you. But the spiritual energy is inaccessible. What to speak of spiritual energy? The Atma which is driving this body you know, even with all their vernier calipers and screw gauge and telescope and electron microscope, they will never be able to detect the soul. Correct, no?
Ashcharyavat pashyati kashchidenam. Ashcharyavat vadati tateva chanyaha. Ashcharyavakchayana manya shrunoti. Shrutvayepi vedana chaiva kashchit.
Krishna says, huh? You know, people see the soul as amazing. Huh? And even after hearing a lot, many people don't understand their, because they are mudhas. He says, Utkramantam sitamva punjanamva unanvitam imudha nanu pashyanti. Pashyanti. There was a professor Kotowski, Prabhupada met him in Russia. So, he was the HOD of the Department of Religious Studies in a very big post in a big university in Russia. And then Prabhupada, while talking to him, Prabhupada came to know that he doesn't know the difference between body and soul. And Prabhupada took a lot of time to explain to him how the soul is the driver of the body and body is different. So, he asked, Swamiji, please slowly tell me, am I the body and have you got a soul inside? He asked, no, you are not the body. You are the soul, you have got the body outside. And I was wondering, how is it? You couldn't understand. Yeah. I have heard about the soul in India, people talk. In Hindu studies, they talk about soul. I have been thinking till date that I am the body and I have got some soul inside. Like you have something in your pocket. Like that he was thinking. Afterwards, Prabhupada, wherever Prabhupada went, he said, I went to Russia, I met one Professor Kotowski. And he says he is a HOD of religious studies, but he doesn't know difference between body and soul. He was very amazed. Ashcharyavat, therefore he says, Vimuda na anupashyanti, pashyanti jnana chakshusha. Krishna says that. How the soul resides in this body, how the soul leaves the body, how it occupies next body. You know, these things are not understandable to people, he says that. So therefore, the spiritual energy, one has to hear in Guru Parampara and gradually the truth will become manifest by Krishna's grace in our heart. Otherwise, they keep simply imagining only an inactive state such as impersonal Brahman. See, yesterday also one more point we read, that impersonal philosophy means negating the negative, but no engagement in the positive. They just negate the negative and go to zero. That's all. Yeah. And then Prabhupada says, this is simply the negative side of material life. Yeah. But such imperfect knowledge, the Mayavadi philosophers conclude that the cosmic manifestation is a transformation of the Supreme. Yeah. And thus they must necessarily also accept the theory of illusion of the Supreme, Vivartava. However, if you accept inconceivable potencies of the Lord, what are the inconceivable potencies of Lord and His devotee? Prabhupada has given very graphic examples. For example, a woman's body, you know, or any female's body, at a certain time starts giving milk, right? No, the breast milk. It's not that she can give breast milk any time of the, when a girl is little, small girl, she cannot give milk from her breast. Even when she is grown up and she is married also, still she cannot give any milk. But the moment a child is born, the breast starts giving milk. Same with cow also. Cow generally gives milk when a calf is put. Yeah. So, it's achinta shakti, Prabhupada says. Because the mammary glands are there, but they only give milk when a child is born, because Krishna arranges that. Okay, child is coming now, so along the milk has to come. That is why there is a song in Hindi which says, Jab daant na te, tab doodh diyo, jab daant honge, tab gehu na doge. Like that, there is one song. Like, you know, when now daant has come for us, so we don't want just milk only, we want chapati. So the person who has arranged for milk for you at the time of birth, will not arrange chapati for you? He will arrange everything, isn't it? So, this is called inconceivable potency. Similarly, Prabhupada gives example of how cow is able to convert grass into milk. This ability is also called inconceivable potency, achintya shakti. Because there is no machine where you can put grass at the top, you get milk at the bottom. Even after science has become so advanced. Now, scientists may say there are some enzymes in the body which convert it into milk. Prabhupada says, why didn't you create the enzymes and make milk? Can't you do that? Why didn't you do that? So, the powder milk which they say, that is actually artificial, correct, no? Which is like imitation of milk. It's not nowhere close. They say that cow's milk is the only milk which is a substitute for breast milk of a mother. Do you know that? You can't give powdered milk. So, you can see it's inconceivable potency. Similarly, Prabhupada says you take a needle and a bird, you drop it. Needle comes down, bird goes up. Which is more heavy? Isn't it? Because inconceivable potency, the jiva has the ability to fly. which the needle doesn't have. Needle is jada, where jiva is chetan. So the heavy dough that flies up, the lightweight needle comes down, huh? Because the jiva has achincha shakti. Similarly, if you see this dolphin, dolphin sleeps with one eye, this side of the brain switches off. And then one eye is open, why? To save from enemies. And then, after some time, he gives rest to this eye and he opens this eye. He takes care. So that means he's always awake with one eye. Can any of you do that in the night? Sleep with one eye and other eye in the computer. They're also doing work. Can you do that? Isn't it? So he has given, Lord has given inconceivable potency. There is another fish which has got a torch in the head. You know, you can see the, and it is putting such a jet-like torch, which goes long distance. It is coming from his head. It is just like the train light you have seen, headlight. Like that it gives out light. It's ordinary fish. It is given that special achintya shakti. So, there are yogis who gain one of the ashtasiddhis. They chant a particular mantra. They lift their arms, from here light comes. Like walking on water, flying on sky. There is one ability to emanate light from the armpit. They do that. So, now how they recovered that ability. Similarly, you take some herb in the hand and you can chant a mantra and then you disappear in one place and reappear in another place. Similarly, there is anima, mahima, lagima, prapti, ishita, vashayita, kama vashayita, all those things are there. That means, you, as a yogi, practicing yogi, one can revive all the inconceivable potencies which are already there in the soul. Different abilities. Therefore, they can fly on sky. Ability to fly is there in the soul, but in your current body, that option is now suppressed, access denied. Therefore, we can't fly now. But in a yogi's body, the access is released. Correct, now? Like in computer also, you have seen server? They stop the access, no? Server only they call it, server. Server, they don't give access to you to certain things. But can they release access or not? Administration office, correct, no? They release. Similarly, for example, yogis do meditation, everything. Through that, they come to a point where they can get release of the access. Then they can get access to walk on water, fly on sky, things like that. You understand, no? So, yeah. Like that they do, correct, no? You can't access it, yeah. They control the access, correct, no? So, why I am telling you, these are all achintya shaktis of whom? No, soul. Right now I am talking only, if a tiny soul has so many achintya shaktis, I only talk 3-4, we can talk about hundreds and thousands of them, which man is himself very surprised, how the jivas have, this, like for example, dog can sniff and find out a thief. Can you sniff and find? Do like that, can you find? Who is the thief? Simply by sniffing your nose? No, dog is given the achintya shakti to find out a thief. So in this way, different. Like our eagle has telescopic eyes, isn't it? Very special. So these are all special abilities to be able to see a very distant object and things like that. Now, let us come to Krishna's inconceivable potencies. They are extraordinary. Like Lord Rama can look at the ocean. The whole ocean was boiling. Correct, no? His eyes are so powerful. Simply by glancing the ocean, he made the whole ocean boil. Or Lord Vishnu, he wants to create a baby. From his own neighbor, like that he brings out the lotus, in which who is born? Brahma is born. And those potencies are not there with the soul, although Lord has them. So Lord's inconceivable potencies are far more oceanic than the inconceivable potencies of the soul. That has been, like for example, a yogi can expand into 9 forms, but all the forms will do the same thing. If one form is doing brushing the teeth, all forms will also do like this. Whether they have brush or not in the hand, they'll be doing like this. Isn't it? Whereas Krishna can expand himself into 16,108 forms, and each form is in different palace doing different things. See, therefore large inconceivable potencies are enough. That's what Prabhupada is saying. See, if you accept the inconceivable potencies of the Lord, we can understand how the Supreme Personality of Godhead can appear within the material world without being touched or contaminated by the 3 modes of material nature. Lord need not be touched at all. He need not touch the matter to bring about a change in matter. Example I gave you yesterday, Lord Vishnu produces Brahma in his navel without having to have any sambandha with Lakshmi. Correct, no? Yeah. I read further.
From the Shastra.
We already explained this. Touchstone and gold. I showed you the verse there, isn't it? It's covered there, yeah. So that means, you know, the touchstone is Lord Krishna himself. And the cosmic world, the millions of universes coming, they are compared to the gold produced. Correct, no? Like that. Yeah. Here he is saying that Lord is directing Durga Devi. Maya Adhyakshena Prakriti. That doesn't mean he does everything. He is only supervising. Supervising means what? Adi Akshena Prakriti. Adi means above. Akshena means watching. Supervision. He is doing supervision of Durga, how she is doing. Yeah. And then he is talking about Durga Shakti, how she expertly. Prabhupada gives a beautiful example that when some guests come to somebody's home, you know, the man turns to the kitchen and he gives some, what do you call it? Ingit desa, no? Ingit? Ingit desa. Indicating, yeah. He just moves his eyebrows and wife immediately understands, okay, special guests have come, isn't it? Immediately she'll cook something and bring. And come and serve everybody. Similarly, Krishna has to just glance at nature and give some indication. All jivas have come here, please give them some eatables. Immediately, Durga Devi will start making, you know, grains, fruits, cereals, spices, everything she makes. By the arrangement of. So, which are those two eyes which are showing indication? The sun and the moon. The sun and the moon are looking at nature. Sun creates rains and produces the crops, isn't it? And moon supplies six types of juices. So in this way, by Krishna's glance, which is Shambhu, and the Shambhu's interaction with material nature, everything is produced in the material nature. Even our bodies also. This is all Durga Mata's contribution. This one, what we have, Panchamahabhut. Once, as well as Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj was telling, right now all of you are inside the womb of material nature, he was telling. Wondering, really? Are we in the womb? We thought we were wandering here and there freely. No, this is the material nature and you are inside it. Jiva is now sitting inside it like this. Correct, no? So, she has given these materials, 24 material elements inside which we are sitting. So, Lord's glance has put us inside. So, that means Shambhu and Devi Parvati, they are coming together. Through them, he is making it happen. Correct, no? Like that he is saying. Vyasa Branta Bali Sai Sutre Dosha Diya. Vivartavada stapiyache kalpana kariya. Yeah.
Shankaracharya states that the theory of transformation presented in the Vedanta Sutra implies that the absolute truth itself is transformed. In this way, the Mayavadi philosophers denigrate Srila Vyasadev by accusing him of error. They thus find fault in the Vedanta Sutra and misinterpret it to try to establish the theory of illusion.
Now Prabhupada is very nice. See what Prabhupada says. First, Brahma Sutra says, Atato Brahma Jinyasa. Prabhupada says, the second aphorism immediately answers, what is that Brahma Jinyasa you have to do? Janmadyasya Yataha. Absolute truth is the original source of everything. And read further.
The absolute truth is the original source of everything. Janmadhyasya yataha does not suggest that the original person has been transformed.
See, the word Janmadhyasya yataha means absolute truth is the source from which everything has come. That doesn't say that absolute truth itself is transformed.
Rather, it clearly indicates that he produces this cosmic manifestation through his inconceivable energy.
Here comes the point, same point, that by his inconceivable potency, the Lord is creating many things without undergoing any change himself. For example, in this world, you will see that when a man and woman come together, and then they produce a baby, correct, no? And they gradually undergo transformation from, we say, no, kaumaram, yavanam, jara. And then after jara comes mrityu. So these are transformations of the body. It happens, correct, no? But such transformations don't happen for the Lord. That's the whole point. He can produce something, but he can remain untouched by it. Yeah. Go ahead.
This also clearly explained in the Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna says, Mattaha sarvam pravartate. From me, everything emanates. This also confirmed in the Taittiriya Upanishad, Yatova imani bhutani jayante. The supreme absolute truth is that from which everything is born.
See, this is confirmation. Brahma Sutra, second sutra says, Janmadhyasya Yataha. Taittiriya Upanishad says, Yatova Imani Bhutani Jayante. Huh? Yeah. Which one? But Aham Sarvasya Prabhavo, he says. Correct, no? Yeah, correct. And Mundaka Upanishad states, Yatorna Nabihi Srijate Grhanatecha. Yeah.
The Lord creates and destroys the cosmic manifestation as a spider creates a web and draws it back within itself.
Hmm. And the same example is quoted in the Bhagavatam also. Brahma says that. Yeah.
All of these Vedic statements indicate the transformation of the Lord's energy, not of the Lord Himself. Transformation of the Lord's energy is called Parinamavada.
And that is Vaishnava philosophy. Yeah.
However, being very anxious to protect Srila Vyasadeva from criticism, Shankaracharya became a pseudo-gentleman and put forward his theory of illusion, Vivartavada. Shankaracharya concocted this meaning of Parinamavada, and by word jugglery he endeavored very hard to establish Parinamavada as Vivartavada.
So, Vivartavada says that because Lord cannot undergo transformation, therefore Jagat Mithya, I told you yesterday, that's the point he is making. Jivera Dehe Atma Buddhi Seyi Mithya Haya Jagatiya Mithya Nahe Nashvara Matra Haya. You understand? A simple meaning. What he says, Jivera Dehe Atma Buddhi. If the Jiva is thinking, I am this material body, that is Mithya. Correct, no? That is illusion. Not that Jagatiya Mithya Nahe. This material world is not Mithya. Understand, no? Nashvara Matra Haya. It is only temporary and perishable. Which means, for example, earlier there was a log of wood tree. Now you cut it into pieces and then you made this table now. You have transformed its form. Correct, no? Now, in case you are finding some shortage of, you know, firewood in your kitchen, you can cut this further. Make it into sticks. And then you won't call it table anymore. Correct, no? Because the shape has changed. And then you can feed it in the chula. Correct, no? So it is a transformation of the same thing from one to another. Correct, no? From the tree to the table, table to the firewood, like that. Similarly, he is saying that the material world, material elements, the total, sum total of material elements remains the same, 24 material elements, but it is shapes and forms are changed. Huh? Like for example, from dust thou art born, from dust thou shalt return, we say, no? So the net quantity doesn't change. The net quantity of matter remains same. Although it may change the shape and form. That's what he's saying. Nashvara matra haya, he's saying. Yeah.
Regarding the just 24 elements, Prabhuji,
yeah.
They are then full in Mahatattva.
Yeah.
So, how it is they are having stock? In the sense, I understand five gross elements and three mind, ego, intelligence. That can be stocked, but how other like nose, you know, or karmendriya,
yeah.
How can we like stock, you know, Mahatattva? Means how we can understand this?
No, in Mahatattva, you will not find multiple noses there. The noses and ears, it won't be like that. But this shape, see, therefore, Brahma and Durga collaboration is there. Brahma has got the template and Durga supplies materials. For example, chapati ka atta, one kitchen devotee does it now. Yeah. He is the person who supplies the atta of chapati. There's another devotee who makes round. Or sometimes paratha also, square, you know, triangle also they make. Correct? Sometimes triangle, sometimes round. So he gives the shape. So the shape giver is different. And the person who supplies material is different. So Durga only supplies materials. And Brahma has got all the template for 8.4 million species. And that knowledge was given by Lord Vishnu to him. Jnanam paramaguhyam me yadve jnana samanvitam tadahasyam tarangam cha grahana gaditam maya. So in those four verses, Lord speaks to Brahma, no? So there he says that, I will give you the intelligence, how you should give bodies to all the living entities. And then Brahma creates different living beings. Those 10 creations, Gandharvas, Rakshasas, correct, no? Different. So he has got all the templates with him, provided by the Lord. In those templates, he takes the material and fits them. 8 point. Just like a pot maker has got the mud, clay, correct, no? With the clay, he makes like, you know, round pots, sometimes plates also, sometimes long pot also. And then he arranges them, he puts them in the fire, and then, you know, makes them dry. Or he puts in the sun, correct, no? Then they are all arranged. So now the wheel, you know, in which the pots are made, that is like Durga, correct, no? The wheel in which it's made. And the farmer who is, you know, doing like this and then making it happen, that is a Virat Purusha. Virat Purusha actually is, all the materials are in his body. The 14 planetary systems, no? They are all arranged in his body only. Therefore, Garbhodakshaya Vishnu only expands as Virat Purusha. From the navel of Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, the lotus which comes, that only is Virat Purusha, which comes, no? In which the Satyaloka is the skull. Bhupa Dovyasya Navir Veda Suranila Chandra Surya Ushchanetre Karnavasha Shirodhya Urmukumapi Dakano Yasya Vastre Yamabdihi Antastam Yasya Vishwam Surana Rakagago Bhogi Gandharva Daityaihi Chitram Ram Ram Yatetam Tripuna Vapusham Vishnamisham Namami. This is the description of the Virat Purusha. That means, you know, all the different species are existing in different planetary systems. But the planetary systems themselves are a part of Virat Purusha. You have seen the picture of that Virat Purusha running, one man. Correct, now the mountains are his body and the trees are his hairs, you know, the ocean is his nabi, and the day and night are his closing and opening of the eyes, and Maya's magical attraction is his smile, you know, and the birds chirping is his sound. Like that, there are, you know, description in the Bhagavatam you will find. So in his body, you know, all the planetary systems are arranged. And Durga Mata participates in all the three. Srishti, Stiti and Pralaya. In Srishti, what does she do in Srishti? You know, Vishnu is glancing at Durga and the glance is Shambhu glance. Correct, no? So, through the combination of Shambhu and Durga, the materials, because in the mother's body, even for all of us, mother gave us this body. And the Atma came from where? Father's semen. Correct, no? Father gives the semen. Similar, Krishna says, Aham Bija Pradaya Pita. Anybody knows who is that Pita? Shiva. Prabhupada says that. In the lectures he says, Aham Bija Pradaya Pita is Shiva. So Shiva is the father of our body. And Krishna is the father of our soul. Correct, no? So, in this way, the Shiva Parvati combination has produced this form for us. So, now the senses are not in the gross body. This is not the sense. This is just like, what do you call it? Like a decoration over the sense. Like this. Huh? Yeah, like that only. Yeah, correct. This is like a window. Actual sense is in the subtle body only. The man, buddhi, ahankar. Which comes now.
So
in that man, buddhi, ahankar, the subtle five abilities are kept. Shabda, sparsha, rasa, rupa, gandha. Those five are kept. And then they manifest through these five holes. And eyes and nose and ears and all. Yeah.
Then they are saying 24 elements.
Yeah.
So that how that Karmendra is only, it is not talked about this kind of thing.
Jnanendriya. This is Jnanendriya.
No, I am saying Karmendriya and Jnanendriya also.
Correct.
So they are talked about only for subtle bodies, not for the gross body.
No. Gross actually, body. For explaining to people, we say these things. But later on when you read Bhagavatam, gradually you will come to understand that actually our senses are in the subtle body. Yeah. They are not in the gross body. For example, you know, If you pluck out someone's eyes, for example, you know, he doesn't see, he's blind, correct, no? For example, when we put the eyeballs we put, he's able to see. When a person is blind, he can't see, correct, no? When you put proper eye, he's able to see. So, who is seeing, if you see? So, the seeing requires five people. I told about that once, correct, no? The Surya Dev, and then the eye lens, and the subtle bodily chakshu, in the subtle body, and the soul, and super soul. All five are in one line, then only you can see. So, people don't know how complex is seeing. Similarly, each of the senses, like the ears, like the nose, like the tongue, everything. Otherwise, the material body is a dead body, it is. It can't function, do anything. The presence of the soul with the subtle body makes this body lively. Like if I take a glove and do like this, glove appears to be moving, you know. Glove doesn't have any life. The body is like a glove over the soul. In a blanket over the soul. When you take the hand, gloves will fall like this. Therefore, the soul goes out, body falls. Otherwise, body has absolutely no value. All right, we can go ahead.
Pranavaye Mahavakya Ishwarera Murti.
Pranavaye Mahavakya Ishwarera.
Pranavahaite Sarva Veda Jagat Utpati.
Okay, this section we will not read so much about the purport. Why? See, here is 174 is starting now. 174, 175, up to 177. Okay, we can just read the translation. Read the translation, Prabhu. It's not required because it will become very long. Read this translation.
The transcendental vibration Omkara is the sound form of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. All Vedic knowledge and this cosmic manifestation are produced from this sound representation of the Supreme Lord.
Okay, it's a short purport only. The same thing Prabhupada says here. This form of His holy name is accepted as a transcendental vibration. Krishna says, you know, Pranavas Sarva Vedeshu, he says. Okay. And then 175 he says,
Tattvamasi Jiva Hetu Pradeshika Vakya. Pranava Namani Tare Kahe Mahavakya.
Yeah. The subsidiary vibration, Tattvam Asi, you are the same, is meant for the understanding of the living entity. But the principal vibration is Omkara. Not caring for Omkara, Shankaracharya has stressed the vibration Tattvam Asi.
Yeah. See, this Tattvam Asi, Prabhupada will explain here. What is the meaning of this? You are not the material body, you are the spirit soul. That's the meaning of this. But Shankaracharya applied it to say that you are that supreme. Tattvamasi. Now you will explain that in purport. Read the purport.
Tattvam Asi is accepted as the primary vibration by one who does not accept Pranava, the transcendental sound incarnation of the holy name of the Lord, as the chief principle in the Vedic literature. By word jugglery, Shankaracharya tried to create an illusory presentation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead in his relationship with the living entities and the cosmic manifestation. Tattvamasi is a warning to the living entity not to mistake the body for the self.
Correct, na?
Wow.
Yeah. Correct, na? Yeah. Yes.
Therefore, Tattvamasi is especially meant for the conditioned soul. The chanting of Omkara or the Hare Krishna mantra is meant for the liberated soul. Srila Rupa Goswami has said, Ai Mukta Kulair Upasyamanam. Thus, the holy name of the Lord is chanted by the liberated souls. Similarly, Parikshit Maharaj says, Nivritta Tarshair Upagiyamanat. The holy name of the Lord can be chanted by those who have fully satisfied their material desires or who are fully situated on the transcendental platform and devoid of material desire. The name of the Lord can be chanted by one who is completely freed from
so
material
contamination. Ranya Abhilash Dashi name is quoting. But Shankaracharya has indirectly minimized the value of the principal Vedic mantra Omkar by accepting a subordinate vibration Tattvamasi as the most important Vedic mantra. Understand? So two big mistakes he has done. What is it he is saying? One is Omkar should be given all prominence because Om has more than 1,000 meanings. It is very much glorified in the Vedic literature. Even Krishna accepts it. He says that Om ityeka ekaksharam brahma vyakharan ma manusmaran. He says, no, yaprayadi samadbhavam yati nastyatra samshayah. For the 8th chapter, Attaining the Supreme, there he talks about the yogis can chant Om and they can actually position themselves in spiritual planets if they want. Of course, some of them may desire to go to Siddha Loka and get powers and all that. But if they desire to go to Vaikuntha by chanting Om vibration and meditating on the Lord in the heart, they can go back. It's possible. So that is primary sound vibration, but Shankara has not given importance to that. Instead, because you know, you can't say, I am Om, you can't say that. Can you say? Yeah. I am that Omkar who is doing everything. People will laugh at you. Hey, what are you talking? You know, are you the ultimate Omkar that you are doing everything? So therefore, he took the secondary statement, which is Tattvamasi, and tried to teach people that this Tattvamasi means, you are that supreme yourself, like that he taught. You are his Tattvamasi. Even if we take him as supreme also. Okay.
You are his.
Yeah, you are his. Yeah. Our Rasaraj Prabhu says, no, we are all not gods, but we are gods. He says, God apostrophe, yes. I like that only. It is. Eya mate kalpita bhashye shata dosha dila. Bhattacharya purva paksha apara karila. Yeah.
Thus Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu criticized Shankaracharya's Sharika Bhashya as imaginary, and he pointed out hundreds of faults in it. To defend Shankaracharya, however, Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya presented unlimited opposition.
That only they both can understand. Therefore, everything is not given here. Vidandachala nigraha dhyaneka uthaila. Sabakhandi Prabhu nija matase sthapila. Yeah.
The Bhattacharya presented various types of false arguments with pseudo-logic and tried to defeat his opponent in many ways. However, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu refuted all these arguments and established his own conviction.
Purport.
The word vitanda indicates that a debater, not touching the main point or establishing his own point, simply tries to refute the other person's argument. When one does not touch the direct meaning but tries to divert attention by misinterpretation, he engages in chala. The word nigraha also means always trying to refute the arguments of the other party.
That's what he was trying to do. Bhagavan sambandha bhakti abhideya haya. Prema prayojana vede tina vastukaya. This is a very important verse, huh? Memorization verse it is. I'll repeat again. Bhagavan sambandha bhakti abhideya haya. Prema prayojana vede tina vastukaya. Yeah?
Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu continued. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is the central point of all relationships. Acting in devotional service to Him is one's real occupation. And the attainment of love of Godhead is the ultimate goal of life. These three subject matters are described in the Vedic literature.
Yeah. Bhagavan, Bhakti and Prema. Correct, no? He is saying, between Bhagavan and Bhakta, there is a sambandha. Hmm? And Abhideya is the Bhakti. And the goal is Prem. Correct, no? Yeah. And then he is saying, Vedesha Sarve Rahameva Vedya. Krishna is saying, Manmana Abhavamad Bhakto. In this way, and through the Varnashrama, the goal is to ultimately please Lord Vishnu. Like that he is saying. Araye ye kichukahe sakalayi kalpana. Swata pramana Veda Vakye kalpena lakshana. Yeah.
If one tries to explain the Vedic literature in a different way, he is indulging in imagination. Any interpretation of the self-evident Vedic version is simply imaginary.
Yeah. Prabhupada says, when a conditioned soul is purified, he is called a devotee. A devotee has a relationship only with the Supreme Lord. And his only occupation duty is to execute devotional service. Yasadeva Parabhakti is quoting Savai Pum Samparo Dharmo and all that. Yeah. Okay. Acharya ra dosha nahi Ishwara agnya haila. Atayeva kalpana kari nastika shastra kaila. So here onwards, 180 onwards, he is going to say why Shankara did what he did. The reasons are coming now from this onwards. Okay, read this.
Actually, there is no fault on the part of Shankaracharya. He simply carried out the order of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He had to imagine some kind of interpretation, and therefore he presented a kind of Vedic literature that is full of atheism.
Swagamai kalpitai swamcha janan mat vimukhan kuru. Mamcha gopaya yena syat. Srishtir Eshottarottara. Yeah.
Addressing Lord Shiva, the Supreme Personality of Godhead said, please make the general populace averse to me by imagining your own interpretation of the Vedas. Also, cover me in such a way that people will take more interest in advancing material civilization just to propagate a population bereft of spiritual knowledge.
This is from Uttarakhanda, Padma Purana. Huh? So why the Lord told Shiva like this, you may wonder. Why he would ask Lord Shiva to mislead the public. Prabhupada explains in TLC very beautifully. Teachings of Lord Chaitanya, I read. Prabhupada says that when Kali Yuga comes, lot of, you know, Vidharma, Chaladharma, there are five types of Apadharma. You have seen that? Who explains that? Where Narada explains to Yudhishthira Maharaj, you know, the seventh canto, later chapters you will read. If you put Chaladharma, you will get in Bhagavatam. You will get. So, in Kali Yuga, a lot of cheating religions come. Upadharma and Vidharma, Chaladharma, like the five types of improper religious things come in Kali Yuga. So, now it becomes difficult to know for you who is a Vaishnava and who is not. Like when I went to Bengal, one gentleman told me, Prabhuji, my father and mother are going to join as Vanaprastha in the Guru's Matha. They are going to go and join. So they are leaving next week, they are leaving home and going there full time. They are going to stay there and all he was telling. So I met the father, I saw Tilak on his forehead. Then I praised Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and said, oh, you also wear Tilak, you appear to be a Gaudiya Vaishnava and you are very blessed and fortunate, I was telling. So he said, not exactly, he said, but you are wearing this Tilak, I said. He said, our philosophy is, you know, Chaitanya Pat Shankara Mat, he was telling. We also dance, we do kirtan, bhajan, we use Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's movement to feel happiness in this world. But our goal is to merge in Brahman. You're selling. So he wears a tilak like us, just like that. He wears. Of course, there was no Tulasi. What is the meaning? That means I am only God only. Because actually, Lord Krishna can wear only this. Without this, he will not wear. Because we keep this because it is Tulasi. Correct now? We wear this and keep Tulasi. So, now when you look at him externally, he looks like a Vaishnava. So, he can get cheated. Therefore, Supreme Lord is telling Shiva, you preach this Mayavad in such a way that many such cheaters will get attracted. Correct, no? It is the best way. Like you, for example, if there is a stagnated water somewhere, lot of mosquitoes will come there because it becomes a breeding place for the mosquitoes. Similarly, if any philosophy tells that Jiva is the supreme enjoyer, so there are many religious people who will go running for it. Because they want to merge in Brahman and they want to claim themselves as supreme. Correct, no? Now there are many people, who are attracted to learning yoga from ladies. They want to learn. Whether they are attracted to learning yoga or bhoga, God knows. Correct, no? Isn't it? So, you will see that in this way you create a facility situation and immediately you will find people of that type will come. You will see that. So here the Lord told to please make the general populace averse to me by imagining your own interpretations of the Vedas and also cover me in such a way that people will take more interest in advancing in material civilization. So actually Prabhupada says materialism and Mayavad there is not much difference because both are bhogis only. One wants to bhog of the material enjoyment here. One wants to have the last snare of Maya. What is it? To become one with God. Actually, that way materialists are chota-mota enjoyers. Mayavadis are big-time enjoyers. They want to take away the position of God. So, therefore, the Lord told him to do this. To separate them.
Mayavadam asat-shastram prachannam bauddhamuchyate. मयैव विहितं देवी कलौ ब्राह्मणमूर्तिना
या लॉर्ड शिवा इन्फॉर्म्ड गॉडेस दुर्गा द सुपरिंटेंडेंट ऑफ द मटेरियल वर्ल्ड इन द एज ऑफ कली आई टेक द फॉर्म ऑफ अ ब्राह्मण एंड एक्सप्लेन द वेदास थ्रू फॉल्स स्क्रिप्चर्स इन एन एथिस्टिक वे सिमिलर टू बुद्धिस्ट फिलोसफी
या
The word Brahmana Murtina in this verse refers to the founder of Mayavad philosophy, Shankaracharya, who was born in the Malabar district of southern India. Mayavad philosophy states that the Supreme Lord, the living entities and the cosmic manifestation are all transformations of illusory energy. To support this atheistic theory, the Mayavadis cite false scriptures which make people bereft of transcendental knowledge and addicted to fruitive activities and mental speculation.
Yeah. Now, why people become addicted to fruitive activities and mental speculation? Because you are actually trying to understand God. But then when you go, you come to know that you are only God. Correct, no? They will say, once you are liberated completely, you will be God eventually. So, then people generally tend to think, if I am the ultimate enjoyer, why not enjoy now also? Correct, no? That's what one tends to think. There is one verse which is spoken by four Kumaras. My dear Lord, if the Jiva is falsely taught that he is the supreme enjoyer, I mean, ultimately, he is the supreme Brahman, then all the Jivas, not knowing their part and parcel nature, they will assume themselves to be the Vibhu and not Anu. And by such false imagination, they will all get further entangled in material enjoyment, imagining themselves to be enjoyer. So, therefore, one more example I'll tell you, you will understand what I'm saying. Bhaktivinoda Thakur in Chaitanya Shikshamrita, he writes, even Krishna's pastimes with the gopis, the Ashtakaliya Leela, should not be presented to the common folk, common people. Because if they read this, you know, different times of the day, pastime of gopis and Krishna dancing and everything, if people hear this, immediately they will repose their material consciousness on Krishna, Radha, considering that to be like a boy-girl relationship. Then they will become debauchees, he says that. They will simply become debauchees. It has happened to many people. There are many people who directly went to Rasa Leela without purifying the heart. And the result was that they became completely degraded debauchees themselves. There are people who were caught by the police and put behind the bars, so-called Mayavadi gurus or people like that, who fell down with their own disciples. So, there are fools who teach their followers that actually, you know, you can marry someone, but you, with me, you can have a parakeya relationship. Like a svakya parakeya. So, there are gurus who have done rasa dance with their people who fell down subsequently. Like that fellow, what is his name? Bishak Sen. In Bhaktivinoda Thakur brought him to punishment, no? Yeah, there are people like that. So, in this way, they have polluted the world. Rather than purifying the world, they have polluted the world with the same understanding of so-called Krishna's pastimes. So, therefore, Bhaktivinoda Thakur says there are two stages for a jiva. One is Vaidhi Bhakti, one is Raganuga Bhakti. So, the people in Vaidhi Bhakti should hear Naimithika Leela. And what is Naimithika Leela? Naimithika Leela includes his earthly pastimes or killing of the demons. Also, Krishna leaving Vrindavan and going to Mathura and Vrijavasis feeling separation. Krishna going to Dwaraka and how he ruled in Dwaraka. So, these are Leelas actually for very good for the jiva. As well as large pastimes in Vrindavan with mother and with friends and everything. And Raganuga, when one goes, then one can actually meditate on one of the characters like Sridhama, Sudhama, Madhumangal. You take one hero amongst them and meditate on their activities to become a covered boy. Or Lalita, Vishaka, Sakis or the Manjaris. So, they are, first you have to practice the Manjari. Then you become a assistant Sakhi to Lalita Vishaka and all that. Then you are allowed to directly report to Radharani. Those are very advanced stages. And joining the rasa dance and things like that. So, if a conditioned soul whose heart is not yet pure tries to get into this Ashtakaliya Leela and tries to, you know, understand about the Siddha Deha and about his Swarupa, Swarupranali and all these things, Prabhupada saw in Vrindavan there were so-called gurus with beard and long hair smoking bidi and they were giving Siddha Pranali. Prabhupada said, see, these so-called gurus, many were young boys also. Prabhupada said, these young boys, with the past urine, they don't wash their feet also. And they are giving Siddha Pranali. And they are having bidi, they pass water and they don't wash feet and they are smoking bidi. And they are giving Swarup Pranali. Can you imagine? And some ISKCON devotees used to go also to get their Swarup from such people. And Prabhupada told Are you not being fooled? Huh? Just see, look at you. You are being fooled by these people. And on the other hand, ISKCON, even a first initiated devotee follows such strict standards. Therefore, people have to be shown black and white the glory of Prabhupada's movement. Huh? How much in our movement Prabhupada brought up the discipline, huh? From first initiation, second initiation, and then you go higher. In case some people fell away due to their own mischief, you know, that you cannot quote it as an example. You may find some examples of people falling here and there, but the majority of the movement you will find follows the style that Prabhupada wanted us to follow. Such a pure movement, everyday hearing, Nityam Bhagavad Seva, doing morning program. He was telling, one of the Maharajas was telling, you, ISKCON program is so good, he said, you simply do the program for life, you will go back to Godhead. He said, because the activities you are doing every day is like Godhead activities only. If somebody is ready to do this day in and day out, what Prabhupada has given us. So therefore, one should not fall prey to Sahajyaism or Mayavada. Because both of them will lead you to the addiction of fruitive activities and the material enjoyment. Yeah. Shuni Bhattacharya Haila Parama Vismita Mukhenani Sarevani Haila Stambita. This is the first shloka where response of Bhattacharya is different. Transforming response, yeah.
Sarvam Bhattacharya became very much astonished upon hearing this. He became stunned and said nothing.
Prabhu kahe Bhattacharya na kara vismaya. Bhagavane bhakti parama purushartahaya.
Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then told him, do not be astonished. Actually, devotional service unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the highest perfection of human activity.
Atma Rama Paryanta Kare Ishwara Bhajana. Aiche Achintya Bhagavanera Guna Gana.
Even the self-satisfied sages perform devotional service to the Supreme Lord. Such are the transcendental qualities of the Lord. They are full of inconceivable spiritual potency.
Atma Ramascha Munayo Nirgranta Apyurukrame Kurvantya Haitukim Bhaktim Ittham Bhuta Guno Harihi.
Yeah. Those who are self-satisfied and unattracted by external material desires are also attracted to the loving service of Sri Krishna, whose qualities are transcendental and whose activities are wonderful.
See, simple verse it is. Atma Ramascha Munayo. Why the word cha is used? Atma Ramas are considered to be people who are self-satisfied. Like, you know, Apuryamanam, Achalapadisham, self-satisfied. But Atma Ramascha Munayo. Nirgrantha. Nirgrantha means they became free, liberated from all bondage. Nirgrantha. Api Urukrame. Urukrame is Supreme Lord who has parakram activities, very amazing activities. Kurvanti ahaitukim bhaktim. Even they render unmotivated devotion service to him. Ittham bhuta guno hari means such are the qualities of Lord Hari. So when Mahaprabhu said, you know what Mahaprabhu, Sarvamana Bhattacharya asked, can you please explain this verse? Mahaprabhu said, first you explain first, he said. Now you will tell him now. You will see here.
Shuni Bhattacharya kahe shuna mahashaya. Yehi shloker artha shunite vanchahaya.
I am desiring to hear the meaning of this verse from you. Like that Bhattacharya told him. So that he can defeat it. But what Mahaprabhu said?
Prabhu kahe tumi ki artha kara taha age shuni. Pache ami kariba artha yeva kichu jani.
Yeah. God replied, first let me hear your explanation. After that, I shall try to explain what little I know.
There is it. Shuni Bhatta Acharya Shloka Karila Vyakhyana. Tarka Shastra Mata Uthaya Vivida Vidhana.
Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya then began to explain the Atmaram verse, and according to the principles of logic, he put forward various propositions.
Navavida Artha Kaila Shastra Matalaya. Shuni Prabhu Kahe Kichu Ishat Hasiya.
Bhattacharya explained the Atmaram verse in 9 different ways on the basis of scripture. After hearing his explanation, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, smiling a little, began to speak. The Atmaram verse was discussed at Naimisharanya at a meeting of many great sages headed by Shaunaka Rishi. They questioned Srila Suta Goswami, who presided at the meeting, about why Srila Sukadeva Goswami, a Paramahamsa already in the transcendental position, was attracted to a discussion of the qualities of Krishna. In other words, they wanted to know why Sri Sukadeva Goswami engaged in the study of Srimad Bhagavatam.
Yeah. So Sukadeva Goswami went to forest. You all know that. Yampra Brajantamanuvetam Upedakrityam Dvaipayano Brahakatara Ajuhava Putreti Tanmayateyatara Bobinedus Tamsarva Bhutakrita Yamuni Manatosmi. He said, no, that was, he went towards the forest and Vedavyas went behind him. Then why did he come back home? You know, did he feel some homesickness? And then he said, no, he is a Brahman realizing Jnani. How will he feel any homesickness? No. And then he said, did he become fearful of the jungle? Lions and tigers are roaring or something. Yeah, realizing Jnani has no fear at all. Prabhupada writes in 16.1, he completely is fearless. Even if a lion or tiger is passing next to him, he will not be fearful. He is completely realized, Brahman realizing Jnani. He had no fear also. You know. Did he feel that he has not studied the Vedas well? Maybe he wanted some coaching again on Vedas by somebody. No. What to speak of learning the Vedas? He is already, his eyes are open. He is a Jnana Chakshu he has. Studying Vedas is a previous part. Now he has realized the soul. It's not that he has to learn anything new. In fact, he saw the naked woman taking bath in the pond and he had no attraction. That means he is fully realized in Jnani, isn't it? Tasya Putra Mahayogi. He says, no. Nirvikalpo Samadran. So he had attained a very high platform of seeing the soul in each body. Then why did he come? So like that, there are 8 questions are asked about Sukadeva Goswami. Why did he come back? Did he suddenly develop a desire to get married so that he can stay at home and get married, do a job or something? No. He had no desire to marry at all. No, he saw the woman, he couldn't see them as woman, he saw them as souls, spirit souls. So in this way you will find there is a lot of discussion goes on between Sukadeva Goswami, Suta Goswami and Shaunaka Rishis. But then finally there is only one answer he gives. Ittam Bhuta Guno Hari. What is that? Lord Hari has such amazing transcendental qualities. The jnanis who are in the stage of 00, Brahma Bhuta, Prasannatma, Na shochati, na kankshati, samaha sarveshu bhuteshu mad bhaktir labate param. That last word is very important. Why mad bhaktir labate param? Because ittam bhuta gunohari. Lord Hari has such amazing transcendental qualities. Therefore they engage in bhakti. Whether it be Chatushkumaras, whether it be Sukadeva Goswami, such personalities. So the ocean is always standstill. But when there is a full moon in the sky, the tides also go very high. So, at that time, similarly, a devotee is very sober and very shy, generally. But when it comes to roaring kirtan, devotee forgets his external identity and starts jumping. And you wonder, such a shy devotee, how is he jumping here, you see? Any of you have seen like that? Anybody was a very shy and sober devotee, but in kirtan, he showed his full form. You seen that? There are people like, so, that is because devotee feels greatly ecstatic. You will find that. So, that's what he is saying here, that, Now, that is about the talk that went on between them. Now, 191 onwards, there is just a talk only. There is not explanation about Atmaram here much. Just there is only some information about Mahaprabhu gave, how many meanings he says. You know how many meanings he gave? How many? 19, huh? 18. 18 meanings he gave, which were completely different from what? Whatever 9 he gave, Bhattacharya gave. Later on, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave 63 meanings, correct? Huh? So that is the one which I took the whole lecture on. It's very nice, the different type of jnanis, yogis, when you combine these words, it will come. Now we will conclude for today. Tomorrow when you come 187 onwards, sorry, this is 191, no? Okay, 191. 191 onwards you continue tomorrow, okay? And then from 191 to 215, this whole dialogue ends. So tomorrow, first 15-20 minutes, this dialogue will get over. That is going to give darshan. And in 199 verse, is going to give darshan of Vishnu and Krishna. That means another 5-6 verses after that, Lord gives darshan to Bhattacharya, surrenders flat after that. Then the new Bhattacharya, how he behaved at 216, so nectar will flow. Now, once he becomes a Vaishnava, how he behaves is very amazing. So the 191 to 199, few verses we will read tomorrow and then proceed with the further section. Shri Prabhupada ki. Thank you very much.